In this video, we're going to be comparing Backendless to Xano. We're going to be comparing three things. Number one, the pricing. Number two, the features and use cases. Number three, the design and onboarding. And at the end, I'm going to tell you which platform I would choose. What is Backendless? Backendless is a platform where you can create apps. It allows you to have a UI builder all the way to creating a backend. You can do this all with Backendless. Xano is a platform where you can create a backend for your no-code project, and it's fast and it's really easy to scale. Let's take a look at pricing. If we look at Backendless and we go to the pricing page, there are several different tiers depending on what we're trying to create. You can start for free, but I would really have you take a look at the full pricing to break down what you need for your project. There's the Springboard, Cloud 9, and then Cloud 99. This is going to vary regarding how many API calls you're going to be creating. And if you're not familiar with API calls, it's allowing two different systems to talk to each other. So how many times are they exchanging conversations, basically? It also breaks down the database tables, push notifications, and also this is important to note at the bottom where it talks about fixed limits and super scaling. That's important depending on your app and what you're doing. So if that's really important, I would go into the details and understand if you need it to be flexible with the limits and scaling. Even with the free plan getting started, it's pretty generous with the unlimited API calls. It's a really good starting point. And unlimited push notifications. I click the detailed button and now this allows me to understand more details of what's happening if I want to use Backendless and where I should begin. On the flip side with Xano, if we go to pricing, again, there are a few different options, and just like Backendless, we can start for free. It allows us to have unlimited APIs for free, 100 records of data, allows us to have image uploads, but with a watermark, no background tasks, and rate limited. Makes sense, it's free, and again, there's quite a few limitations with that. But unlimited APIs, and to get started, I like it. If we move over to Essential and Prototype, what stands out in my mind is the storage limits. This really comes down to the type of app or type of platform I'm trying to build. It really is going to depend on what kind of storage limits that I need. Am I doing something with a lot of pictures or videos, or what kind of information or items am I storing? That's going to really depend on the storage that I'll need. I like the prototype where it's talking about the 100% dedicated resources for the region specific. That it depends on what you're trying to do, but that could be a huge thing to consider. If I'm comparing on price, I'm going to look at both, but really the thing that comes down for me is the exact type of app I'm trying to create. That allows me to then pick the right kind of platform or to think about the right kind of platform regarding if pricing is a huge issue when I'm getting started. For example, if I'm looking at storage, I can go to the Cloud 9 and a plan for Backendless, and I can take a look at the file storage right over here, and then I can compare it to Xano. So if I'm looking at 10 gigs of storage, starts at 59 for Essential. If I go to Backendless, I can get 10 gigs of file storage starting at 25. And again, those are just a few things to compare. Look at what you're trying to create and what is beneficial for your app. Also, too, if you're looking at it, if it needs to be scalable, those are things to consider and to look at the detailed billing of what it can offer for you and your app. Next up, we're going to be looking at use cases and case studies and which one would be best for you. What I do like about Backendless, if you go over to features, they have a bunch of different case studies of different companies that have been using them. And then if we go into integrations, it actually shows me how Backendless could be working in some of my projects. For example, if I'm using Backendless with Adalo, it gives me step-by-steps how I would be able to do it. And I thought that was extremely helpful. With Xano, I've been seeing a lot of people on Twitter talk about how they use it for their project, and I have seen how it's integrated with a few. I would like to see on their site just a few more use cases or more detailed how I could be using it in my project. That's something to consider, and maybe they have it in their blog, but I haven't seen it as prominent as Backendless, so there's something to consider. Again, when you're looking at this, I would probably look at what do you need this for? For example, like Backendless, it's saying that it can be used as their database, also their UI builder. We'll get to that in a second. But Xano, if you're thinking about using this for your business, what you're doing for your project, actually their onboarding is very helpful in how that's presented. And so we'll go into that next. Next, we're going to be looking at the design and onboarding. Let's start with Backendless. Once you sign up and you're going to be taken to your screen, it's going to ask you if you want to start with an app. And this is the basics to get started. You're going to have this option to start with the backend or front end. This is the beginning section. The front end, again, we might do another video in the future, but we're going to focus on backend. But they do have a front end builder right here. And it reminds me of like, I think it was like Visual Bakery. It was like a plugin for WordPress back in the day. But for what we have right here, the backend, it allows us to get started and go from there. Also, too, they have different lessons to begin with, and then you can start from here. This is the dashboard. If I want to see how the data is constructed, we can be right here for the app tables, the app views right here, and this is what it looks like. We can also see the files, business logic, and then code generation. On the flip side, let's take a look at Xano. When you get started with Xano, you're going to be onboarded and they'll actually ask you what kind of project are you creating. And you can say, I'm trying to create a marketplace or whatever. And then it actually gets started with the structure of your database to get going. Now, it's not perfect. It's the beginning steps, but you see where it says like listings and users and reservations. It gives me a prompt of what am I trying to create, and then it will get me started. From there, also too, we have a quick guide, a quick start guide. And I like this because it's breaking it down. Even what is a backend, it gets really, really basic for me, and then I can go from there. Next, if I click database, I'm taken to my database, and then I have my tutorials to get started. What I like about this is, for me, it's very, very easy to understand, and the structure, it allows me not to feel overwhelmed. I already know where my major tables are and what I need to do. And again, I have my tutorials. The tutorials are about 90 seconds to begin with for this specific one on tables, and then go from there. Also, if I look on the left-hand side, now I'm seeing my API group. And again, that's how, if I'm going to have two different systems talking to each other, I have this right here. I have my library that I can start adding my functions and everything like this. And then I also have a marketplace where I can start being able to use other templates to get started. Now, I mentioned before how I started with a rental marketplace. This allows me to other types of databases or the structures very quickly, so I can start iterating and moving in the right direction. This is just a bonus, but I thought it was really smart. When they have the Xano orientation, it's the 24-hour special. Like, so they're incentivizing you to start getting involved with their platform. They're giving you a reward to learn more to help your own business. I thought that was really smart to just get started when you have your new account. Again, if I'm comparing the two different platforms just to get started, Xano allows me to feel very empowered and allows me to systematically get started. When I look at Backendless, yes, it is very powerful, but there's a few things that I would note here. When I was going to go through this, looking for examples of people's workflow, how to use Backendless, what I have tended to see was Backendless was used with ones that already have extensive background in developing or already coding. So when they're in Backendless, their workflow is totally different than when I'm working with no coders that are taken to Xano. That's what I've noticed. I've asked for multiple people to show me their workflow in Backendless, and usually they're using it. They're using their past experience in development or something like that. And so there's no streamlined approach that I've seen so far. In the comment section down below, if you're using Backendless, I would love to talk to you or see how you're using it or what kind of projects. And also let me know what kind of experience you have. Are you a no coder? Are you a developer that also uses no code? I'd love to hear it as well. if I'm picking between the two where I'm looking at the design and onboarding, I'm going to be going with Xano because I liked how it was progressive. When I got started, they were asking a lot of questions about me, what kind of business I was trying to run, and then they gave me those options found in the marketplace so I could get started with my databases a lot easier, and to me, it was a lot more concise. If you're using Xano or you've decided to use Backendless over Xano or vice versa, let me know in the comment section. And then let me know, why did you choose one or the over the other? I'd love to know. Also, too, there is a lot of students in one cohort that was using no-code tools. And they were using Xano, and they were able to iterate so much quicker because of the intuitive nature of Xano and how they were able to create databases. If you want to see more videos about Xano or how we would use it for projects, please let me know. And if you're using another database for your no-code projects, such as Google Sheets or others, let us know that as well. After looking at Backendless versus Xano, which one would I choose for my no-code project? And the winner is Xano. I would use them because, number one, the onboarding was spot on. I like the different examples for me to get started. And also, the way the tutorials were set out, it didn't feel burdensome. It felt like I could do this at my own pace. It felt really good and it felt refreshing. Not only that, the UI UX I liked, maybe just because it was lighter, but it felt better and it was a lot less confusing. With Backendless, I could see the potential and I could see that there was so much wrapped up in the platform, but trying to navigate and what I should use in my workflow around the platform, for me, felt very cumbersome and I didn't enjoy it. So as I'm looking at the comparisons, I would use Xano. If I'm looking at pricing and you're saying, well, Backendless has more of the things that I need. Again, like I mentioned in the pricing section, I'd really look at the pricing comparison in the exact things that you need for your projects and then also your budget. What are you trying to create? All of those things. But the free plans were very similar. And also, too, to scale it and what I'm trying to do, if I'm worried about price, I'm really big on creating the MVP first, making sure that people are buying the pre-sale or they're buying into the project, and then I'm going to be able to scale based on pre-sales. So for my pricing structure, for the most times when I'm creating app projects, my validation is seeing if people are going to pay. And so then I'll invest it back into something like a backend for my project. So I would use Xano with that. If I'm always looking for more case studies, I will say this, the Backendless case studies, I did like the step-by-step. I wish that they had videos on that using it for like Adalo and others, but I did appreciate those in-depth blog posts about how to use Backendless with Adalo in other platforms. I would like to see videos with that. If you like these kind of videos, make sure that you like this video and subscribe to this channel. We do this every single week. And if there's another comparison that you want to see, either with a database platform or just any no-code platforms in general, let me know in the comment section down below what you want to see. I'll see you in the next video.